So excited to be here, guys. My name is Francesco, and this week I'm in Amsterdam here, and we're meeting with so many core developers behind the merge. And today we're just catching up and, you know, like speaking with a few experts. What basically is expects to lead up the biggest change to Ethereum since its launch in 2015. So with me this morning, I mean, you guys will introduce yourself, but we have Tim from the EF, Matt Nelson from Hyperledger Basel, and Chris from Infura. Do you guys want to introduce themselves a little bit and what you guys doing, you know, like relatives a little bit on the merge side? Tim?
Sure, yeah. So I work at the EF, Ethereum Foundation, and there I run what's called the L-Core Devs calls, where the different developers working on the Ethereum protocol get together to discuss changes to the network. And the big change we've been working on for basically the past year now is Ethereum's transition from proof of work to proof of stake, which we're calling the merge.
Yeah, and I work on one of the client teams that is part of the merge. So I am a product manager at Hyperledger Basel, and we are an execution client that is hoping to be merge ready and to work great after the merge. And we're going to get into a little more about what an execution client is if you know, the folks here are not familiar, which I'm sure they are, but really excited to talk through this.
Hey, I'm Chris Anatalio. I'm a platform advocate for Infura. And over at Infura, mainly we are coordinating with the protocol team to minimize the impact to our users so that they have almost no lift to transition to the merge.
Nice, nice. So as I said before, it's awesome to having you here. I know you guys have been a lot of those community calls of consensus, but you know, having everybody here in Amsterdam is just great. So I guess we can start. So let's start with some basic. I just want to open up with you, Matt. And you know, just for getting a little bit started on the viewers here, like, so what is the merge like with like, you know, like responding, like speaking to a child, and how this will change Ethereum?
Yeah, as Tim said, it's really about a protocol upgrade moving from proof of work to proof of stake. So when people hear the word mining, that's what we think around proof of work. And that's kind of the approach to consensus that's been used in Ethereum since 2015 and relies on computing power to have the network run and have the network reach consensus. The merge is referring to changes that will bring us to the future of Ethereum, which is proof of stake, where we use economic incentives as opposed to mining in order to reach consensus around what transactions go onto the network, what money moves here and there, and all these different things that we're going to see changing. But there really are four primary impacts that are going to make Ethereum kind of a lot better for end users, for the planet, for developers, and much more. And they're kind of around diversity and openness. So we're going to see a lot more client diversity. And when I say client, I typically mean the software that runs on Ethereum nodes. So these are the network components that talk to each other, that confirm the transactions, that reach consensus, and allow us to deploy apps and to do different things on the network that we kind of take for granted today. But in the future, we're going to see a lot more of these clients. We're going to see, hopefully, a diversity of them. And we also see layer two technology come into the picture to really make the network a lot more healthy, scalable, and again, diverse. We're also going to see really great energy efficiency gains. The Ethereum Foundation estimates upwards of 99% reduction of electricity, which is absolutely fantastic. We don't want any, of course, this carbon footprint to continue to go on. So that was kind of one of the chief factors in the merge and reworking the way that Ethereum works is having it sustainable for the future. The next is kind of the economics of the network and having Ethereum function as sound and secure money in the future. And by that, I mean kind of the crypto economic penalties, rewards, and supply constraints that are changing after the merge and have been intentionally designed around a new way to secure the network for end users, for the currency itself, and for developers and DeFi protocols themselves. And kind of lastly was the hard work that all these client teams have put in and the Ethereum Foundation to make sure that this transition is kind of seamless. Of course, we don't want any disruption to the network as it stands today, and we want to make sure that developers have great developer experiences going forward, that the clients work as they expect, and we're doing tons and tons of testing here in Amsterdam, here, you know, elsewhere for the last several months, years almost. And, you know, folks like Infura, for example, who have been, you know, really working hard to ensure that their apps and infrastructure are ready when we flip the switch.
Yeah. That's very interesting to say. I mean, you touched on different points, right? Incentives, the developer experience, testing. I think we will go through on those things. And I mean, you touched on the last point on the Infura side. Obviously, it's playing a huge kind of like role in the ecosystem with ETH, right? And my question is from the developer kind of experience. Like, I would like to understand from you, Chris, like, so what should developer expect and how and or what kind of preparation those guys should do pre-merge? Is there anything you want to add on that? Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. What's going to be great is we are trying to minimize the impact to developers. They are going to have virtually no lift to migrate to the merge, basically. So you're going to be able to use the APIs, the JSON RPC calls, just like you do today. The schema is going to be very similar. And the main changes are going to be in naming. So the Ethereum API is going to be called the execution layer, and what we are currently calling the ETH2 API will be called the consensus layer. We're going to be updating the documentation, and we are going to send out communication about which testnets will be supported post-merge. Specifically, if you have a use case which you are concerned about, you can reach out to your customer success manager, and they can work with you directly to mitigate any changes you may have to make.
That's very interesting. Actually, I want to touch on the client and diversity and openness. And you, I mean, a little bit for you, Matt. Like, why you think this is important? Because right now, obviously, we have the situation as we want right now. And I mean, I just want to understand why this third point that you mentioned earlier is an important point to touch.
Yeah, sure. So, you know, today in Ethereum, we have, again, a number of what were soon to be called execution clients. And they have been a centralization point of the network for a little while, only insofar as that we have some really good ones and some up-and-coming ones that have led to a little bit of a disparity in usage. But the problem with this is that post-merge, this can create consensus challenges. So if you have the majority of the network that's running on one client or one combination of clients, we can see that, you know, there might be the issues if a bug arises that could stop consensus and cause some challenges across the board. But with this new architecture where we have an execution layer client and a consensus layer client, it's allowed us to kind of reevaluate the architecture and how we're deploying these. And it's also created new incentives to use different clients, right? And we're designing several to be merge ready. So again, Hyperledger Beisu that I'm working on, and Teku as well that our other teams are working on. And you know, there's a variety of different client teams that we're all working together to ensure interoperability and kind of a standardization of an approach in order to make sure that we can make it easy to use as many different clients as possible, which will again help us address these kind of majority client issues. And you know, selfishly, you might say, I would love everybody to use Hyperledger Beisu, but that's not the case. We want, you know, an even split. I would be so happy to see, you know, 20 to 25% of across the board for all these clients so that we can really enable kind of an openness of our approach and to spread the risk, right, as opposed to centralizing it in one point. That's kind of the diversity that we're looking to create. On the openness side, it's more about equitable participation.